Alguns três perguntas. Quais as implicações de pensarmos cultura como travel, viagem, né? E não como mais do que como lugar, principalmente se nós pensamos nas populações nativas? Outra pergunta. A ênfase, quais as ligações possíveis mais profundas entre a ênfase no digital e todo o aparato tecnológico que o informa com o capitalismo e a constante necessidade de uma mudança que, no meu entendimento, muitas vezes se transforma numa intensa necessidade de compra?
Consumo.
Aí que eu coloquei buy em inglês, consumo. E que a senhora abordou agora também na última colocação, como pensar na esquizofrenia que vivia entre as ideias de mobilidade, de não fronteiras e as cada vez maiores restrições de países, de muitos dos quais derivam, né, alguns pressupostos teóricos que até nós, que nós compramos muito facilmente. Obrigada.
Thank you. Three wonderful questions. To the first question, there is not necessarily a contradiction, I don't think, between thinking of culture as mobility and the claims of indigenous peoples to a particular territory. It does depend on the nuances. In Canada, I know at least, indigenous people had their own territory, but most of them were multilingual. They spoke the languages of their neighbors, they traded, and they often moved long distances as part of their living. And I think that that's true of many indigenous cultures. Certainly, in Australia, indigenous peoples had a particular territory they were responsible for, but it was a territory they traveled through rather than a territory they farmed, for example. So I think you do need to be very careful when you define culture as mobility, to recognize that that requires you to rethink mobility and to move beyond opposing so-called nomads to so-called settlers. It involves a rethinking of many of the categories we take for granted and assume are normal. So I think it's potentially very provocative and very useful for indigenous peoples as well. The second question was about the... I think it's a tension between those who desire the internet to be a free, open, even anarchic space, and the capitalist forces that increasingly see it as a new source of income. And at the moment, I think that we as academics can certainly do our bit to support open source and open access publication of our work to counteract that. I try now to post my work on the internet to make it available. So it's part of that open dialogue that we have, rather than forcing you to go to a British publication company that charges a fortune for an article or for a book. And increasingly, our granting agency, the equivalent of CAPES, SHRC, is requiring those of us who receive research grants to make our work publicly available, rather than available through commercial sources. I think, though, that we need to recognize that the internet and many of the things we love about it are not there to serve our interests. They're there to serve their interests. I just read a book called The Googleization of Everything that it itemizes in very interesting ways how Google has shifted and changed and what some of the implications of how the search functions operate are. I know myself that when I Google something from Canada, I get an entirely different list of results than when I Google it from Brazil. You've probably seen that yourself. I love my Kindle, my Amazon Kindle. I can travel with 500 books now on the plane. But you have to recognize it's a tethered appliance. That means that every underline I do, every bookmark I put, every note I write in the books that I buy is stored somewhere in the cloud, and Amazon has access to it, should they wish. I mean, what they do is they aggregate it with other readers, and when you read a book on a Kindle, you can see 30 other people underline this sentence. So you can get a sense of the wisdom of crowds, you know, how groups of people are thinking. This is very useful to advertisers. So I think what we need to do is we need to get involved in devising our own search engines, in devising our own open access publications, devising as soon as new inventions become available, you know, either be part of inventing them ourselves or part of making sure that they genuinely serve the interests of the public, the interests of cognitive justice, as I suggested. The third question is even less easily answered, even shortly, I think. Because again, it's a question, I guess it's a question of the hypocrisy of the so-called developed nations in increasingly wanting to control their borders, control immigration, at the same time as theorists within those systems praise the mobility that we have to travel much more freely, both imaginatively through access to the internet and physically across borders. Without so many visa troubles. I think the world situation is changing very rapidly. I think, again, we as academics have a responsibility to counter the fears of migration that are being spread throughout Europe and North America. I think it's very, very important that models of Canadian multiculturalism and Quebec interculturalism that really do work, that are working well. You know, that information needs to get out there because there is so much in the media now that is designed to try to convince even Canadians, you know, that multiculturalism, we thought multiculturalism was good for us, but really it's bad for you. So I think the novels that show how it is working in countries like Canada are extremely important to teach and to study, and also the studies that show how it could work better, because it's by no means perfect. There's a lot more we could do to enable people from different backgrounds, cultures and religions, sexual orientations, to live more equitably amongst ourselves, but I think that is something that we are well positioned to do, and we shouldn't shrink from that task.